see that he's worthy of. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I'm here to give God praise. How about you this morning?
Amen.
Now, I don't want to start no stuffing here this morning, but you know, I've been saying that the 8 o'clock crowd has become the 11 o'clock crowd on Sunday mornings. It's so much fire and so much presence in here at the 8 o'clock that I think the 11 o'clock has got some coming up to do. So don't disappoint me, 8 o'clock. Come on, let's give God some praise in this place this morning. Amen. Would you rest on your feet as we prepare our hearts for worship? Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you, yielded and still before your presence. We ask you, oh God, that you would meet us in this place. We pray, oh God, your blessings upon this service, that it would be carried out to your will, glory, and purpose. Forgive us of all our sins and shortcomings and all our proclivities and those things that keep us at bay from coming to you. We pray right now that your Holy Spirit would just arrest our hearts in this moment and allow us to fall prostrate before your presence, surrendering our will to yours, asking that your will be done in us, even as your will is carried out in the heavens. Let your glory fill this place, filling our hearts and equipping us with what we need to be proper witnesses of your kingdom and of your power and of your glory. We pray, oh God, your blessings upon the preached word this morning. Let somebody's heart be touched, healed, delivered, and set free. We thank you that in the midst of crises, in the midst of turbulence and trial, that you are still God, and we will praise you as such. And we will not allow any intimidations of the enemy to hinder our praise on this morning. But with uplifted hands and an open heart, we receive from you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Put those hands together one more time and bless him. Hallelujah. All right, come on, everybody. Let's praise the Lord. Everybody ready? Come on. Put your hands on it like this. Here we go. Come on. Yeah. Hallelujah. Now, by now, not only should you, your heart be racing, but you ought to feel the praise in your heart right now. Amen. Because God is good. I said God is good. And he's worthy. Despite the taunts of the enemy, despite the challenges of life. And how many understand that as we contend with the vicissitudes of life, it does not negate us or prevent us from giving God what's just and due to him. Amen. The psalmist said, I will bless the Lord when?
All times.
Come on, FBC. Come on, you know this. I will bless the Lord when?
All times.
And his praise shall continually. That means it doesn't matter what I'm going through, but in the moment, in the thickness of it all, I will praise him because he's worthy. I bow before you. I surrender to you that you would be glorified and that you would be magnified in each and every moment of my. And Lord, I'll admit sometimes I don't get it right, but you grace me time and time again. I've given me chance after chance, opportunities after opportunities to bless you. And so we take you up on such an opportunity this morning, and we bow down. Hallelujah. Come on, lift those hands if you will. How many didn't come for form or for fashion, but you came with an expectation and with a desire to receive from God this morning? I've been through too much hell to not praise him now. Hallelujah. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I've already come. 'Twas grace that brought me safe thus far, and it's his grace. The song simply says, bow down and worship him. Worship him. Oh, worship him. Hallelujah. We bow down and worship him as I enter in. Oh, enter in. Bow down, bow down. Everybody say,
bow down and worship him.
Worship.
Worship him.
Oh.
Oh, worship him.
Everybody bow down.
Bow down and worship him. Enter in. Oh, enter in.
Consuming fire.
Yes.
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 Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. Fire. Amen. You know that fire, sometimes it will burn things up, clean things up, and it'll show things up. Amen. And I believe that's what that fire is doing right here in First Baptist. It is showing what we're made of. Amen. Amen. If y'all bear with me just a moment, be seated. I asked the pastor this morning if I could just give an experience, short testimony this week and send him a message. He didn't get back with me, so I'm assuming that it's okay. Amen. But I will make this as brief as possible. I guess I'll start, Brother Carl, on Wednesday night. We had an open discussion in our Bible study, which was great discussion. But after I left Bible study that night, I started thinking about some things that were said, and Brother Carl told a story about an experience that his son had, and I started thinking back on things about, I had moved to this new town, started a new job, and I got stopped 5 times by the same police officer. So after our discussion in Bible study, I just was thinking some type of way. And got so much into it, I sent Brother Carl, Brother Marvin, Brother Billy, and Pastor a text message on Thursday. I think it was Thursday morning. Might have been late. Might have been real early. I don't know. not really thinking about, you know, the expectation, but maybe I was just thinking somebody's gonna say, yep, let's all ride up. We're going to the state capitol today. I don't know what I was thinking, but I sent a message. So fast forward I went to work Thursday, and as I was walking the store with my boss was in the store, and I got separated from the group. When I walked back up to the group, there was a gentleman there standing talking to my boss, and they waved me over. And anyway, he was said he was in my store. I'm at the Kroger on McMahon. He was in that store on the day after the shooting incident. And I was holding my meeting that morning. And he said he was listening in on the meeting. And he said he was just so amazed at what I said to my people, the deliverance, the calmness. He said, I am a Stony Brook shopper. That was the only reason I was in that store that morning on that Thursday, because that store was closed the day after. And he said, he was telling my boss when I walked up just about how great the message I gave and how on point it was and how it made him feel a whole lot more reassured. So part of the message I sent to the brothers that Thursday morning was praying for what is next? What are we going to do next? And so that let me know right there that all I need to do and all we need to do is remember who we are and whose we are. Amen. Because that Thursday morning after I had prayed about what I was going to say to my people, because everybody was nervous and, you know, they was at, and I let the Holy Spirit lead me. So I figured out whatever I do, I need to make sure it's in Christ. Amen. People are watching us, and let them see the God in you. Amen. So Brother Marvin, Brother Carl, I guess I got an answer to my question about what I need to do. Stay prayed up and stay in the Lord. Amen. Amen. So with that being said, First Baptist, it is prayer time. I'm going to ask my friend there to come and lead us in altar call. He don't mind. Amen.
Church say amen. Let the church say amen again. As we come across the aisles touching and agreeing, why don't you say to your neighbor, I don't know what you had to fight through to get here this morning, but I'm glad you're here. And I'm praying for you this morning, amen. That the God who reigns and rules and has regency in our lives will continue to bless you and to protect you, amen. Please leave no hand untouched. Also want to mention to you that Pastor Coleman is not feeling his best and Pastor McElvaney is not feeling his best. So we want to call those names this morning in our prayers. Amen. Yes, he is, Lord. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed, and every heart is thinking on God. Amen. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. God, how we thank you this morning that when we consider the works of your fingers, the sun, the moon, the stars, what is man that thou would be mindful of him? But God, we thank you that you're so mindful of us this morning, that you continue to watch over us, lead, guide, and protect us, O God. And so, God, we thank you for your protection this morning. There are many things that could have happened, Lord God, but you were in the midst and you protected. We ask that you continue to place a hedge of protection around this place, around this church family, amen. Father God, we pray this morning as we lift up the angel of this house to you, Lord, that you continue to strengthen him and to guide him and to give him the vision for the First Baptist Church family. Lord, is our prayer this morning, God, as we pray for those that are standing in these aisles and kneeling, Lord God, touching and agreeing, we ask that you would be in the midst, that you would make yourself strong this morning, Lord. Show yourself. Invade this building with your presence, Lord God. Fill us with your hope, oh God. And then, God, those of us who are on the fence, God, I pray now that you would help us in our unbelief. Lord, continue to show us that even in 2018, you are still in the miracle-working business. Lord, there's someone here needs a touch from you, needs you to be a physician for them. Lord, there's someone here needs you to be a banker for them. Lord, there's someone here needs you to be a mother or a father for them. And Lord, we know that you are all things, and so we just give you thanks this morning. Father, you know if we had 10,000 tongues, we could not even thank you enough. For truly, you are a good God. You are a great God, and you're worthy of a great praise this morning. And so our hearts are filled with praise. Our mouth is filled with praise and thanksgiving, Lord God. We just thank you this morning. God, then we ask that you would forgive us of our sins, for we've sinned and come short of your word. Oh, Lord, we pray now that your word would go forth, Lord God, in such a way that you would be glorified. Lord, your people would be edified, and the devil would sure enough be horrified. This is our prayer this morning. In Jesus the Christ's name, we pray and so often give thanks. And all those who are in love with Jesus the Christ said, amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. At this time, we'd like to welcome any first-time guest visitors. If this is your first time visiting with us, we'd like for you to please stand. We may recognize you. Amen. First Baptist, one more time, let's give him a First Baptist welcome. Amen. Just a reminder, please make sure that we all go out and exercise our right on Tuesday. Amen. To vote. Also have an announcement coming from the couples ministry. They will meet this Friday at 6:30, but it, due to the women's conference, I believe we will be men only on this Friday at 6:30. And Minister Moses said that he's in hopes now that the men will be more open to talk. I'm just making announcements, you know, He said the men usually seem a little bit timid and afraid when the wives are there. So he's hoping for open dialogue. That's from Minister Moses, okay? Amen. And we do have an announcement coming from Sister Stella, I believe.
Good morning. Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye. Come one, come all to the Women's Ministry Royal Conference on Saturday, November the 10th at 10 a.m. in the Family Life Center. For those women who missed the royal tea we had at Lakeshore Country Club last month, you really missed a royal treat. Don't miss this royal conference. We have invited various churches in the community, St. Stephen's, First Virginia Street, and Harris Creek Baptist, just to name a few. Our special guest is Mrs. Connie White from St. Louis, Missouri, and our own minister, Susan Tosumbo. Right. Come one, come all. So get your tickets. They are only $10. Meet me or one of our team members, Tawana McFadden, in the choir room after the 8 a.m. service or in the multipurpose room after the 11 o'clock service. Please sign up even if you don't purchase your ticket now. We need to have a count of how many women we're attending. Don't let our guests outnumber us. Let's show up in high numbers because love is First Baptist way. Get acquainted night would be Friday, November 9th at 6 p.m. in the lower level. Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye. Come all, come all, come all, and come one, and everyone invited.
Something's
Something special, supernatural, Jesus. Something happens when I meet you. Supernatural is your name, the name of Jesus. Oh, something happens. Your name. Something happens. Oh, Jesus. Oh, something happens. Something happens. Jesus, something about, oh, something happens, oh, when I call on him, when I call on him, in the morning, in the noonday, in the evening, oh, when I call on him, when I call on him. Call on the name of Jesus. Every knee will bow. Oh, 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 yeah. Something happens. Something happens. Jesus. Jesus. Oh, 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 yes. Something happens. When I call him, heaven needs to bow. When I call him, the devil fears his name. But when you call him, yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, there's something about, oh, there's something about the sweet name of Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
How many know something happens when you call on the name of Jesus? I want you to know this morning that it doesn't matter what you're going through. It does not matter what you've gone through. There is power in the name of Jesus. And while the songwriter says something happens, it does not just happen, but it happens to your benefit. It happens to the glory of our God. So when you call on the name of Jesus, you can expect healing to take place, because that's to your benefit and that's to the glory of God. When you call on the name of Jesus, you can expect deliverance to show up at your door, because God is a great deliverer. When you call on the name of Jesus, that which has gone wrong will be made right, because God has the power to turn crooked into straight again. And I stopped by to tell somebody this morning that if you learn how to call on Him, quit whining about what you're going through and learn to call on the name of Jesus. And I wonder if there's two or three folk in the house that know there's power in the name of Jesus. And if you learn how to call on it, I declare He's able to do exceedingly. I declare abundantly above all that we can ask or think. Won't you try for just a moment? Call on the name of Jesus. Call on the name of Jesus. Call on the name of Jesus. Come on, everybody, if you got breath this morning, call His name. Jesus. 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 Hallelujah, hallelujah. Call Him, call Him. Yeah, yeah.
Keeper, Jesus, He's a deliverer. Yeah. Jesus, He's my Savior. Jesus, He's my lifter. Oh, yeah. Something happened.
Amen. Give God a big hand clap of praise. Come on, give God a big hand clap of praise. I said, we didn't come to be on no program. How many came to worship this morning? Give God a big hand clap of praise. If God's ever done anything in your life, give Him a big hand clap of praise. If He's ever brought you through anything, give Him a big hand clap of praise. Call His holy name. Hallelujah. Amen. How many really want to see his face? Bible teaches us that many will see his face. But we want to see his face and his countenance smiling up on us. Amen. I want to thank God for those of you that are here, those live streaming, those who have committed themselves to helping us to set the atmosphere for worship. We thank each of you for your labor, your toil, realizing that when we gather in the house of worship, it's imperative that we learn how to let go of everything that's in the past and not worry about anything on tomorrow. Set your heart and your affections on things above and on our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. God wants our whole heart when we come together. And so I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank those who are live streaming. And just to reiterate, as I attempt to say occasionally, that if you're live streaming and you're able to get up out of bed and able to go forth to the house of worship, whether it's here or someone else, you need to do that. Because the Bible says, fail not to assemble yourselves, as some have done, and especially as we get closer to the end times. That means that the closer we get to the end, the more God's people ought to gather together and unite as one body. And so I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank those who are present. And just to reiterate, thank our first-time visitors and those returning visitors who are here. And as we continue our theme for the year, knowing God in Christ, growing in God in Christ, sowing God in Christ. And now at this point in our study, dealing with the gifts of the body of Christ. But in light of the recent incidents that have continued to take place in this country, I want to try to merge the two thoughts together, dealing with our gifts and the times in which we're living. And I want us to look at Matthew, the 25th chapter. Now, I've got to read quite a few verses, about 15 verses. I normally don't do that, but for the sake of clarity, I want to do that. So if you turn to Matthew 25, and beginning at verse 14. Reading from the New King James Version, it says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his own ability, and immediately he went on a journey. Then he who had received 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more also. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So he who had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, 'Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them.' His Lord said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord.' He also who had received 2 talents came and said, 'Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents besides them.' His Lord said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord.' Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, 'Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours.' But his Lord answered and said to him, 'You wicked and lazy servant, You knew that I reap where I have not sown, gathered where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at least at my coming I would have received back my own with interest. Therefore, take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have abundance. But from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Will you join me in a word of prayer? Holy Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for your word. We confess our unworthiness and even our inability to be able to disperse your word in a way that would be befitting unto your glory and for the good of your people. However, God, we believe that with you all things are possible. So we pray, God, that your word will go forth and not return unto you void, but accomplish the purpose for which you've sent it. Cause it to resonate with the hearts and the minds of those who will hear it, and then cause it not only to resonate, but to revive us to action, that we might do what you've called us to do. Forgive us of our sins and receive our prayer. God, we ask it in Jesus' name, our Lord and our Christ. And the church says, amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. And just for clarity, I want to read those last couple of few verses. But his Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at least at my coming I would have received my own with interest. Therefore, take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he who will have abundance. But from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I want to talk to you today from the subject, the high cost of doing nothing. The high cost of doing nothing. It has been said that for evil men to accomplish their purpose, it is only necessary that good men do nothing. Meaning evil will always appear to prevail and be triumphant over good because good people by nature choose to remain silent or refuse to use their God-given talents and gifts, their powers or their positions to make the necessary changes in life where changes in life are necessarily needed to be made. Racism and hatred and bigotry, immorality and the decline, the fall of this nation and the American church is a result of good people choosing to do nothing, leaving evil to be triumphant and victorious on a regular basis. However, in our text today, my brothers and sisters, Jesus reminds us that silence and apathy does not come cheap, but it is the higher cost of doing nothing that destroys and that disrupts. The Bible helps us to understand that even political corruption, broken homes, failed families, the apostate church, and the decline of mannerisms and morals and respect is a result of good people who have chosen to do nothing. The societies in which we live, the communities in which we grow up in, have literally lost so much because so many people have decided to do nothing. Church numbers are on a decline across this nation and even across the globe because lazy people choose to do nothing. And I want to suggest today, my brothers and sisters, that as we examine this text, that we will discover that Jesus helps us understand that doing nothing is expensive. In fact, there are those who oftentimes complain about education and talk about the high cost of education. And it is true that education costs quite a bit. But I want to suggest and maintain that it costs a whole lot more to be ignorant than it does to be educated. And that's not only in the secular world, but that's also in the sacred world. It amazes me how many people can grow up in a church and be in church all their lives and be 30 or 40 years into the Word of God and still be biblically illiterate and ignorant of what thus said the Lord. And so I want to help us understand this morning that God has called us to do something. And no person in here, or no person who hears me by way of live streaming, or no person in this world, literally, regardless of what generation they grow up in, has the right to even suggest they can do nothing. Because the Bible tells us here in our text that begins in verse 14, as Jesus starts this particular part of this passage by saying that the kingdom of heaven is like those who plan to go to heaven, those who intend to spend their eternity with him. Jesus says there are some things that ought to be done. And I want you to notice here, he says, for the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling in the far country. The indication is that God has given us something. And there's an appointed time when Christ will return. And upon his return, he expects every person that he has given something to be able to say they did something with what he has given them. And so I want to suggest this morning that as I look at this text, the first thing I want to point out is that God has given everyone a gift or a skill for humanity's good. The word talent in the text and in the Greek simply means skill or gift. That is to say, if we read it in that such, then it would say in essence that he gave one, five skills and gifts. To another, he gave two skills or gifts. But to another one, he gave one skill or gift. But I want you to know that while this word talent means skill or gift, it says that every person has given a gift or the ability or a skill, which is an occupation, to make a positive difference in the lives of others, and especially when it comes to the advancement of God's kingdom. God has given every person born into this world a gift or a skill so that we can somehow take what God has given us and make life better. And so Jesus says, in essence, in this text, that while he has given all of us gifts, he's given all of us gifts based upon our ability. That is to say, God has given some people more gifts than others, but he's equal in his giving. May I suggest, as a father who has four children and six grandbabies and one on the way, I've always said that I love them equally, but I love them differently. Because each one has a distinct personality. And by my understanding of their personality and their personhood, I learn how to deal with each one based on who they are. And what the text is teaching us is that God is not unequal in his giving because he knows us better than we know ourselves. And so even if he only gave you one gift, he wasn't cheating you. He was just saying when he created you, that's all you've got as far as your ability is concerned. But if you learn how to use what you got, how many know if you just take what you got and learn how to plant it and learn how to cultivate it, learn how to water it, something good will grow out of it. And so he tells us God has given everyone, every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, every ethnicity, every nationality, it doesn't matter where you come from, every social status, God has given everybody a gift or a skill, the ability or the occupation of doing something with what God has given you. Adam and Eve is a good example of that. You look at Genesis, the first chapter, verses 26 through 28. The Bible says, God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, the birds and those things, that the cattle and all the things that creep upon the earth. Then the Bible says God blessed them. And God said unto them to be fruitful and to multiply. They had a purpose. And that purpose was to make sure that they would subdue the earth and multiply so that God's will would be fulfilled. Abraham and Sarah had a purpose. The Bible says, according to Genesis, the 12th chapter and chapter 15, that God calls Abram and he tells him that I'm going to make you a father of nations. Because God's perfect plan from the very beginning continues throughout generations. God said, I'm going to make you a father of many nations, but it's not going to be a father just of the Jews. Those who become a part of my family will not just be those of the Jewish descent, but all those who come by faith. And so God puts him to the test, and he tells him to leave his mother, his father, his friends, his family, his loved ones, his country. And he says, go to a place and just start walking, and I'll tell you where you're going when you get there. And by faith, Abraham began to walk. And so he was actually saying, in essence, Abram, when I make you a father, I'm just not making you a father of the Jewish people. I'm making you a father of all those who will come to me by faith and who will believe that I am God and that Jesus Christ is King of Kings. And all who walk by faith will become a part of your family. And that's why I would like to say I don't understand some of the violence that takes place among us as Christians. Because if we're honest, all of us who fight each other come from the same seed. Not only the human seed from Adam and Eve, but if you think about it, the people who are at war with each other all come from the seed of Abraham. Judaism is from the seed of Abraham. Christianity is from the seed of Abraham. Islam is from the seed of Abraham. And it's those three circles of people, our religion, if you will, who's always fighting each other, and we're all from the same seed. The Bible tells us in this text, he says that everybody has a gift or a skill for humanity's good. When you go through the Old Testament, the prophets had a purpose. Paul discovered his purpose in Acts, the ninth chapter. When he discovered his purpose in life, even Jesus fulfilled his purpose when you look at Luke, the 22nd chapter, verse 42, and he cries out to God, and he says, in essence, that he was going to do his will, although he felt like not going through. Here's what it says. Basically, he says, Father, if there be any way to remove this cup from me, do so. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. God has given every one of us a skill. God has given every one of us a gift. God has given every one of us the ability to do something. And only you know how many talents you have. But I declare God expects you to put every one to work. If you've got five, you got to work all five to his glory, but for the good of all. If you only have two, you got to work all both of them. It's for his glory, but for the good of all. Even if you have one, God expects you to put it to work. And I wonder why he uses this parable to suggest that the person with one hear this talent. And I don't really know. I can't answer, but I would like to suggest it's possible because that person compared himself to everybody else. And you know, a lot of times the reason we don't get involved and the reason we don't commit ourselves to the church work and to the business of God's kingdom is because too often we look at everybody else and we attempt to elevate them higher than ourselves. We think everybody else sings better than us. We think everybody else teaches better than us. We think everybody else is capable, more capable than us. And so therefore we sit back and we hide our gifts, or we sit on our gifts that God has given us for the benefit of his kingdom and for the world at large. But we won't do anything because we're looking at everybody else and figure everybody else is better than us. Low self-esteem and inferiority complexes prevent us from doing what God has called us to do. And so we go through life making excuses, saying, if I had this, or if this would happen, or if God would allow that, or if they didn't do this, or if this didn't happen. I stop at it. It doesn't matter what happened. If you got a gift, it will work if you put it to use. Even my own personal testimony for where I grew up in life, grew up in a two-parent home, good family foundation, but got caught up in the world. But even with all that I got caught up in, because the seed had been planted, talk to me, somebody. The problem with today's children, it's not a matter if they're going to go astray. They will go astray. But if they don't have a foundation, if there's no seeds that have been planted, they have nothing to return to. While I attempted to be wild and reckless as a youth, there were seeds that were deposited in my life that no matter what area of darkness I found myself connected to, I couldn't get away from the seed. And over a period of time, it began to cultivate. God began to work with it regardless of what I went through. And then the Bible came true, all things work together. Are there at least two or three folk in the house? See, a lot of us think that verse is only for those who've been saved, but that was even pre-salvation. Those things that you went through, those trials, those troubles, those tribulations, those downfalls were all working together for your good. Everything that you went through that caused you to cry, every tear that fell from your eye, every pain that went through your body, every situation you couldn't get yourself out of, all of that was leading to God's purpose and plan for your life so that all things work together. That's why I suggest no matter what you've gone through in life, young or old, nothing is wasted in time, because God is able to take what you call a waste and make something good out of it. God has given all of us a gift. I think I shared with you a couple of weeks ago, 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, verse 11, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit has given every one of us a gift according to our ability. And I want to suggest this as I head to my next point is, quit asking God for more because he knows what you need. Quit asking for more because if he hadn't given you more, maybe you're not doing anything with what you already have. I tell our young ministers, and even some of them have gone from here, but they used to tell them they always want to be a pastor. But pastoring is not as easy as you think it is. And I've learned and I've said to them that if you want it that bad, you don't have to pursue it. Because if God wants you there, he'll put you there. How many know if you just wait on God and trust God? And if God has a purpose and a plan for your life, wherever he wants to connect you, he'll put you there. You ain't got to go out of your way. You ain't got to talk nobody down. That's one of the reasons I don't like politics. I'll be so glad when Tuesday's over. I am so tired of all these ads and advertisements and commercials that are doing nothing but demeaning other people. You know, it used to be a time when somebody ran for office, they would tell you what they're going to do for the benefit of the communities that they will serve in. But now when you hear the news, see these ads, all they do is dig up dirt on everybody else. But if you got to make yourself look good by making somebody else look bad, what does that say about your character? You ain't got to bring nobody else down. You ain't got to talk about nobody else in a negative way. Just do what God has gifted you to do and let your light shine so that men can see your good works and then glorify the Father in heaven. And that not just go with politics. That goes in the church. Some folk in the church are always running around gossiping about what everybody else is doing. Talking about how bad everybody else is. Just do what you're doing, because usually what you're doing, you're testifying. In essence, you're not doing anything. That's why I've learned not to be jealous of nobody else. I don't care if they got 20,000 members. I got what God has given me. God knows my ability, and you got to learn to work with what you have. Doesn't suggest you don't try to get better. Doesn't suggest you don't try to go as far as you can. But it says, like Paul says, I've learned how to be content in all things. I've learned how to live with much, and I've learned how to live with little. Because it doesn't matter if I have much or little, neither one robs me of my joy.
Doesn't matter if I have little or much. Neither one robs me of my peace. Doesn't matter if I have little or much. Neither one will cause me to be stagnant in life. How many know it doesn't matter what you have, but it does matter what you do with what you have? God has given everyone a gift or a skill for humanity's good. Verses 14 through 15 says, for the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling in a far country who has called his own servants and delivered his goods. And notice they're not yours. They're not mine. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. And he gave to 5 talents to one, and to another he gave 2 to each according to his own ability, and 1 he gave. Immediately he went on his journey. The Bible says all of us have something to work with. Second thing I want to suggest from this text, verses 16 through 23, is that not only has God given us everyone, or given all of us a gift, a skill for humanity's good, but every gift and skill must be employed to be effective. You got to put your gift to work in order for it to be effective. Notice, if you will, in verses 16 through 23, he says, then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded. Now, the word traded, I'll get back to that in a moment, with them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more also. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. And after a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And so he who had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. He also, who had received 2 talents, came and said, Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I've gained 2 more talents beside them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Every gift and skill must be employed to be effective. The word traded in verse 16 means to toil. It means to occupy oneself with, by engaging and committing oneself to the God-given assignment or purpose for which God has created you. That is to say, when every person comes into this world, you must understand, and every parent needs to prepare their children and let them know God has a special purpose and plan for your life. Because every gift that God has given is for his glory, but for the good of humanity. And that is to say that when we fail to utilize the gifts and the talents and the things that God has given us for humanity and for his glory, then that says somebody is missing out. Because can't nobody be what God created you to be? There's only one you. And whatever God has given you, even if you've got the same gift that somebody else has, he's given it to you so that you can use it distinctively different from what he's given somebody else. So when you fail to operate, when you fail to employ your gift becomes ineffective. And I want you to know that in 2 Timothy, the second chapter, 4th chapter, when Paul says in his closing words, verses 6 through 8, he says, for I'm now ready to be poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. But watch what he says. He says, I fought a good fight. Key words, I finished my course. I kept the faith. And now there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the righteous judge, the Lord, shall give me at that day. But not unto me only, but to all those who love his appearing. Paul was saying, in essence, my brothers and sisters, I discovered my purpose. I lived out my life in a way that was pleasing unto God. And I was so committed to the assignment that he gave me that I found the Holy Spirit leading me to say, for God I live. And he says, in essence, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Yeah. In other words, I'm not here for me. I'm here because God raised me up and called me to be a voice in a wilderness, caused me to write the most of the New Testament. God had a purpose for the Apostle Paul. And so when he came to the end of his life, he was able to say, I fought a good fight. It was hard. Some folk don't do anything because of the difficulties of life. But Paul suggests, yes, life is hard. But if you fight the good fight of faith, doesn't matter how hard it gets. How many know that victory is our name? And if you learn how to stand on the word of God, I discover God will stand with you through the storms, through the rains, through the heartaches and the pains. How many know if you trust in the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, God will somehow work everything out for your good but his glory. How many know the word of God is a force to be reckoned with? The Bible says, Paul says, I fought a good fight. I finished my assignment. I'm on my way to the grave, but I'm not angry at God because I'm getting ready to go. I'm not disturbed by the fact that I'm on the verge of losing my head at Nero's chopping block. In fact, like my brothers and my apostles, he says, I find it to be something to boast about. I'm glad that God would look upon me as somebody worthy to suffer for his name's sake. I'm glad to know that God, who could have chosen anyone, decided to choose me and let the devil come against me from every angle, because that says God got confidence in me. I'm glad that he called me this morning. And I don't know about you, but I want to suggest you ought to quit running from the call of God. Quit running from the will and the assignment that God has given you, because it's hard. God knew it was going to be hard, but if God be for you, he's more than the world against you. Every gift has to be employed. Even Jesus helps us to understand that again in Luke 22 and 42 when he says, Father, if there be any other way, remove this cup from me, but nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. In other words, I've got to employ it. If I don't employ this purpose for which you've sent me into the world, nobody will be saved. Do you not realize what I just said? Do you not realize that if Jesus had not fulfilled his purpose, he could have retained his Godship, he could have retained his righteousness, and nothing would have gone wrong with him, but you and I would have been lost for eternity? And so although he cried out and said, Father, if there be any other way, remove this cup from me, nevertheless, not my will. And that's where we got to get to, saints. We got to come to a point where we quit being so selfish and thinking about ourselves and say, God, if it's not, regardless of what I feel like, not my will, regardless of what it costs me, let your will be done. If you fast forward to John, the fourth chapter, my brothers and sisters, our John, the 17th chapter, verse 4, you discover that Jesus says in that verse, I finished doing what you called me to do. And that's the testimony that you and I want to have at the end of our days, that we were able to say we finished what God had called us to do. God has given everyone a gift or a skill for humanity's good. He's given every gift and skill must be employed to be effective, but every gift and skill used or wasted will determine our rewards. Every gift, every skill that we use or waste will determine the kind of rewards we get. The Bible helps us understand that when Jesus speaks to the man with 5 talents who had 10 and the one who had 2 that gained 4, they got the same reward. He says, enter into the joy of your Lord, and I will give you or make you a ruler over many things. They both had different gifts. They both had different amounts of gifts, but they both got the same reward. When he calls this man who hid his talent, I want you to notice that he calls him 3 things. First of all, he says to him, "You wicked." He said, "You knew that I reap where I didn't sow and reap where I haven't scattered seed, and yet you took what I gave you and sat down on it." He calls him wicked. He says, to not use what I've given you makes you wicked. And don't let the devil deceive you by making you think you go through life and then just say, well, God understands. No, he says you're wicked. But the second thing he calls him is not only wicked, which is equivalent to being diabolical, he calls him slothful. He says you're lazy. The reason is not you don't have enough gifts. You're too lazy to use what you got. And so you go through life making excuses and blaming everybody else, when the truth is, when you stand before me, I'm going to call it like it is, you're lazy. And then thirdly, he calls him not only wicked and lazy, but then he calls him unprofitable. Or another word for that is useless. He said to go through this life and not to utilize or attempt to utilize the gifts that God has given you for the advancement of his kingdom and for the advancement of humanity, he says your life is useless. If the only reason you think you're called to live is to live for yourself, to enjoy life, to gain funds and monies that will eventually perish so that you and your family or your immediate friends can have fun, he says your life is useless. God has given you a gift for the world, and he has given you a gift so that everybody can profit from it. And so in Proverbs, the 10th chapter, verse 4, it says, lazy hands produce poverty, but diligent hands, they literally bring forth wealth. Poverty is not just a state of not having money, but poverty means lacking something. And our families are lacking because folk are lazy. Our churches are lacking because folk are lazy. Our communities are lacking because folk are lazy. Our country is lacking because folk are lazy. And Jesus says, if you're not utilizing your gift, your laziness is the result of what you complain about. You don't like the way the country is, maybe it's because you sat down on your gift. Because every person has the ability to make a difference in life. And you may not be able to change the world, but you got enough to change the world around you. And if you change the world around you, those that you help change, God will use them to change the world around them. And then God will use the world to change around. And so before you know it, it begins to permeate and spread throughout the world, but you got to start where you are. And I want to suggest there's a higher cost of doing nothing. The reprimand is you're wicked, you're lazy, and useless. But the reward was utter darkness. He says to this man, because you chose not to use what I gave you, because you didn't even invest it, that is to say you didn't even try. He says you could at least put it in the bank and drew interest off of it. But he said you didn't even try to use it. So therefore, your fate, your eternity, will be in utter darkness. A lot of times we misinterpret the word grace. It is true that we're saved by faith and grace, but your works, as James says, are evidence of your salvation. If you say you're saved and you're not committed to God, you say you're saved and you're not serious about the gospel of Jesus Christ, you say you're saved and all you think about is your wants, your desires, and your will, then you'll discover in the end there's an outer darkness. But I want to suggest if you take what God has given you, and I don't care if everybody else frowns upon it, God will take what you have and he'll cause it to blossom. I remember as I was on my journey to a road of destruction, I was on the age of 22, life had dealt me a bad hand as far as society was concerned. I went to prison the first time for a crime I didn't commit. I became angry at all police officers because it was a white police officer that told me he was going to get rid of me. And he did. I hated the justice system because I found out it was not equal to all people. But I want to show you how God works while I was in that old jail on my way back to prison. God sent a person that I said I would frown upon, a Caucasian elderly man. And he sent that man to that jail cell, and all those who were in there with me decided to go against him and act like they were going to hurt him. And out of respect for him and Christianity, with no intention of giving my life to Christ, I stood up for him. And he gave me a pamphlet on how to escape from jail. But I want you to know, when I got to that pamphlet and I read it, it led me to the Bible. And it didn't just show me how to escape from jail. It showed me how to escape from hell. And I stand before you now 40 years later. And I declare, why I didn't have much to give back then, God took a nobody and made a somebody out of it. And I wonder if there are at least two or three folk in the house that's come to the realization, because Christ died for your sins, because he was buried in your place, and because he rose on your behalf. Although the world said you would never be anything, God said, I can take a mess and call it to be blessed. God said, I can take a nobody and make that something or somebody. God said, you don't have to have a whole lot. You just got to be willing to take what you got and put it in the hands of the Lord. And when you put it in the hands of the Lord, God will take that mess. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. I've gone places I never dreamt of going, because God took a nobody and made somebody out of it. I've talked to millions of folk all over the world because God took a nobody with one little gift that I didn't even know I had, and he used that gift for his glory. Won't God do it? Yes, he will. Yes, he will. I'm a living testimony. If you try him, everybody won't accept you. Some folk will walk out of your life, but you got to trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not into your own understanding, but in all your ways, acknowledge him. He will. He will direct your path. The system, when I went to them and I tried to get my record expunged because I said I was innocent, they would not expunge it. Well, watch what God said. He said they don't have to, because everything you could have gotten had they expunged it, I'm going to do it for you. And anybody that knows me and knows my journey knows that everything I had before I got my master's degree, before I got my undergrad, everything I needed, God gave it to me. And so I've learned in life all this stuff that we strive and we abandon each other for. If you learn how to trust God, in fact, by the time I got my master's, everything I could have gotten with my master's, I had already got more and then some. And so I left it in the envelope for 2+ years because it didn't mean that much to me anymore. But the Lord I serve and the God of my salvation, every time I wake up, every time I think about his name, I just say, Lord, thank you. I got shelter over my head, not because of money that I had, but because of money you put in my pocket. I got legs to walk on, not because the enemy didn't have his way, but grace has been more than sufficient. God will. Come on, I'm done. God will. Take that one gift and use it if you don't hide it. And that's why I've been so transparent about my life. I've had people leave my life because I was transparent. But I don't focus on the people who leave. I focus where God leads me. Amen. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for your word today. There is a higher cost of doing nothing. It's so easy to sit down and make excuses and shake our head about what's going on in the world, what's going on in our communities, what's going on in our churches. It's easy, God, to sit back and be a critic about everybody else. But you're asking us today, what are we doing with the gift you've given us? And what are we doing to make a difference in every aspect of our lives? pray, God, that you would engrave your word in our hearts and our minds until it becomes a living reality in our lives. We ask it, God, in Jesus' name, if there's somebody here today who's disconnected, who's not giving you their best, who needs to be connected, God, we pray that you would lead them forth. In Jesus' name, amen. As the choir leads us in a brief song of invitation, I want to invite you to come today. If you've never accepted Christ, if you want to rededicate your life, become a part of our church family. God has a purpose and a plan for you. He wants to use you to advance his kingdom. He wants to use you to glorify his name. He wants to use you so that somebody else can be blessed as a result of you. Are you willing to trust him today? Are you willing to recommit your life? Are you really willing to rededicate and say, from here on out, God, I'm gonna be faithful. Doesn't matter if I don't have much, I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to be committed. I'm going to occupy in the area in which you've called me. And everything that I can do, I will do for your glory. If you're here today, won't you come?
But to the one that
it's not too late.
Until the end.
If you don't have a church home, would you come forth? Want to rededicate your life? Come forth. Want to become a part of our church family? Why don't you come?
And sometimes
don't sit back and do nothing.
You
give your life to Christ. Say, Lord, today, if you need somebody, I'll go.
I know.
Is that one?
Things
those who are live streaming, you can call in.
Work out. Yes, they
we will assist
will.
You.
For the good.
Maybe seated in the presence of the Lord. It's not too late. If you decide to come after service or to make a decision after we have our communion, see one of these men or women behind me or myself. Whatever you do here today, leave here today with the expectation of giving God your all. Amen. Body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. God, we thank you for this opportunity to share in this time. In accordance to your word, to remember and to reflect upon what you did when you gave yourself as a living sacrifice, that sacrificial lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world, and even before the foundation of the world, for the souls of all humanity. We thank you, God, that by your grace and faith we've been saved. And now, God, we pray your blessings upon the bread that symbolizes the body that hung on that tree that went into that grave for the salvation of all men and women. We pray, God, your blessings upon the blood that was shed for the remission of many. And we pray, God, you forgive us of our sins and unite us as we come together. Bless now this congregation as we attempt to share in this most sacred moment. God, we ask it in Jesus' name, our Lord and our Christ. The church says amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Has everyone had an opportunity to be served? In the upper room, Jesus took his bread. The Bible says he blessed it and broke it. Say, eat ye all of it. Symbolizing the body that would be hung on that tree. He took the cup, raised it up, blessed it, said, drink ye all of it. Symbolizing the blood that will be shed for the remission of many. We want to thank you for coming out today. We trust and pray you will go to our Sunday morning classes, our life application classes, Sunday school, new members orientation, that you would also join us on Wednesday at our noonday Bible studies, and also on Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock, prayer preceding both of those services. Come out and bring someone with you. Every Sunday, bring somebody with you. There are too many lost souls in our families and in our friends and in our communities that are dying because nobody or too many people are choosing not to do something. Let God use you today throughout this week. Be a voice for somebody. Be a voice for Christ. And let somebody know that Christ can redeem. Amen. At this time, we're going to prepare to take up our offering. I'm going to ask that we will give cheerfully and generously, as God has commanded us on our way out, that we will follow the direction of our ushers. And we just, again, want to thank you for being here today. And we trust and pray that you've been blessed. And now, if you've been blessed, then be a blessing. One of the things that I pray on a daily basis is not only do I ask God to bless me, but I ask God that I might be able to bless his name throughout my life and throughout the way I live, throughout the way I give. And so if God has blessed you, turn around and be a blessing to somebody else. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Christ, for the privilege of being able to worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you, God, for today. We thank you for what we have received. Now, God, we pray that we will utilize it for your glory, but for the good of all. We ask, God, as we go to our various classes, God, that we will continue our learning. And then, God, that you would help us to be mindful, to walk in the Spirit, so that when we encounter people during the week, God, we might be spiritually attuned and alert and attentive so that we might be able to share the gospel of Jesus Christ as much as we can. I pray for every home and every heart that's represented here, those live streaming, those who are part of us, those who connected to the body of Christ, praying that your peace and your prosperity and your grace will be sufficient in every area of life. I pray, God, you bless the offering that has been taken up in your name and that will be taken up. Sanctify it and glorify yourself through it. Multiply it, God, to your glory, that as we attempt to help lives and change lives, you might get all the glory, you might get all the praise. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his throne with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, dominion, power, and majesty, both now and forever. Let the believing heart say, amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Have a great week.